today. This is FARRMS's first of four organic transition lunch and learn series that we're going to be hosting. Just this year, we have moved into doing some outreach and education around transition to organic farming, which has been something that we didn't have as much knowledge of in the past. So this program is supported through the United States Department of Agriculture's Transition to Organic Partnership Program, which is administered through the USDA Ag Marketing Service National Organic Program. It's kind of a long-winded way to just say that we're excited to be kind of kicking off this series today talking about organic. And we have with us Ryan from Think Regeneration, who is going to be kind of talking about that transition into organic and some of the thoughts behind it. And we will have the next following 3 weeks, we'll have speakers and farmers joining us who are either already organic certified, transitioning into it, or kind of like working with that certification process. So Ryan, if you are ready, you can take it away.
Thank you, Felicity. It's nice to see everybody today. I hope everybody's having a good day. Assume everybody's, if we wouldn't mind, maybe before we get started, just doing a quick round of introductions. I'd love to hear where everybody's calling in from today. If you wouldn't mind just doing a 30-second version of that. Would Dave or Jake or Katie want to get us started?
Yeah, I can get it. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Perfect. I'm Dave Millis. I am in the West Fargo area. I've got the farm that I grew up on is just northwest of Fargo, so in the Red River Valley here, and I have an opportunity to use a few acres of that tillable land for some sort of farming operation, and I'm just getting my feet wet with this and learning what the possibilities are. So really right now I'm kind of in that stage. I haven't started yet, but I am trying to soak up as much information and make as many connections as I can. So glad to hear about. I don't know where organic fits in with that in the future. I'm hoping it's part of that. If not, the principles will apply. So I'm just hoping to learn.
Great. Thanks, Dave. Appreciate you being here. Jake, you want to go?
Yeah, my name is Jake Callender. I am here in Southwest Fargo. My farm is up in Hillsborough. I run about my operations on a 5-acre plot running fruit and vegetables. And then I'm also the new program facilitator for the FARRMS Beginnings course.
Oh, great. Amazing. Katie, you're next up on my grid, if you don't mind going.
Yeah, I have a diversified vegetable farm in southwestern North Dakota. Organics always intrigued me, but I have a lot of questions about it, specifically the process and the time involved. So I'm excited to hear more about it.
Great. Thanks for being here. Sherelle, did I pronounce that correct?
That's correct.
Yeah, great.
I am with Tri-County Regional Development Council. We are a TA for the Regional Food Business Council. I just wanted to join in and just get a little more information.
Amazing. Appreciate the work you're doing. That's great. Shelby.
Hello, I'm Shelby. I'm the communications coordinator for FARRMS. I'm just kind of here to sit in and listen as well.
Great. Thanks, Shelby. It looks like Dan's still connecting to audio. So, and I know Robert's saving lives, I think is what he said with his as well. So, Robert, can you give us a brief introduction, or are you in a spot to do that?
Yes. Yes. Oh, I'm Robert Barfield, and I've started in an aquaponic greenhouse in my garage. I'm hoping to expand it to like a commercial, but it's kind of like a test grow. So I'm really interested in organic certification for aquaponics. Thank you.
Great. Yeah, thank you guys for being here. I'm going to go ahead and share a screen here and should see a slide up there called Five Realities to Change. And that's one of the things that the presentation we're going to walk through today is we, you know, our organization, Think Regeneration, And the work we do is working with, you know, small groups of leaders around the country who are moving agriculture away from convention and into organic and regenerative spaces. We see a lot of commonalities and we see a lot of unique differences too around the countries we work. And so what we want to hope arm you guys with today and illustrate is just some of the common challenges that you might be experiencing as you move toward organic, as you start thinking about how am I going to change and how am I going to pursue these more niche types of farming systems? And also, how do I build the right support network around me to succeed and truly thrive with these networks? So real quick, my name is Ryan Slabaugh. My background is I founded Think Regeneration last year, about a year ago. Previously, I was the executive director of Acres USA. I taught soil health through books and conferences and magazines and worked with a lot of early adopters and in soil health programs and got to know a lot of growers who were really breaking ground in this space. And one of the things that kept coming up over and over again was the need for real on-the-ground support. And so that's what we started this year was an organization that can be on the ground working with them in a little more intimate way than the 800,000 person conferences that I'd done in the past. This means helping them hold field days to educate their peers, to build, you know, farmer co-ops. That would be the right photo in Illinois. That's Marty Travis with his family farmers there. In the middle is a group of large-scale wheat and chickpea and cattle growers and ranchers in the Spokane, Washington State area. They are working together to try to create a parent brand that they can actually try to grow into the food supply and create some CPG products and some, you know, chickpea flour products and things like that around their farms as well. So they don't have to sell quite as much into the conventional markets. And then the left is a workshop we just did in Kansas focused on human health. The growers there were really interested in how do they detoxify their farms and how do they detoxify their strategies on the farm so that they can really match their goals for the food they're creating with the ecosystems they're building on their farms and their habitat they're building. So all those border on organic. Not everybody in our program is organic by any means, probably less than 10% overall, but they're all interested in moving that direction and leaning that direction. And it really determines on, is there a market there for them to sell into? Can they get that guaranteed price for the organic certification that they're going to go through? Because it is extra work to do the certifications. And there are some things to make sure that you're getting your prices and your costs covered when you go through this. So you can find more information on our website, thinkregeneration.com. Reach out at any time. We'd love to have a conversation with you guys one-on-one as well. That's a thing we spend quite a bit of time doing. This is where our programs are active. We are in the Great Plains. We've done programs in Nebraska, Kansas, Oklahoma, and we're going to work with you guys in the Dakotas now. We'll be in Colorado in a couple weeks doing an in-person program there. I'm based in Illinois here, and I work with about a co-op of about 80 to 90 growers, supporting them with everything from grant writing to just helping them figure out where they can get their truck fixed when the refrigerated truck breaks down. So we support them on kind of a phone call away basis. We just did our first program in Arizona down in the lower left corner, where we got about 40 people in the food supply together on a regenerative organic certified farm. We'll show a video of that here in a little bit to kind of show you the idea of community building around how we bring people together to open markets. And then we've got a program in Spokane where we're building some online courses to help growers get into a biofarming program that they've started through a conservation district there, which is really about growing biology in the soil. Organic certification is part of that program, but not the central focus of that program. This is something we carry forward with every single one of our programs that we do, is that when a person, for whatever reason, has the opportunity to lead an extraordinary life, they have no right to keep it to themselves. And we apply that to every single person on the planet. And we really believe that that's part of the potential that we're trying to tap into when we talk about approaching farming differently, approaching food differently, and approaching it from a quality aspect of how do we build extraordinary lives. And can that be the end result of what we're producing on our farms? It's not just a vegetable. It's not just a piece of beef, but we're actually producing real leaders to lead our world into a better place with our food supply. And that's some of the examples that we've seen, is that when communities have really strong connections with their farmers and their local food, there's all sorts of ripple effects that come out from that. So our model here at Think Regeneration is we connect. Showed some images here of us bringing people together around the country. We continue. It's really important for us to acknowledge that we did not, you know, that there's been so many people working on this for so long, for generations. And we're really humbled to be a part of this. And so many good storytellers have tried to make these types of changes in the past. And this has been going on since the agriculture has been industrialized. And so we've seen folks trying to think differently and trying to build new and alternative approaches to how we cultivate our land, how we build soil health, how we build nutrition through the food supply. And so we'll talk about some of those folks who are paramount to our organization. We create, there's, you know, it's essential that we're helping organizations create experiences, educational, fun, to help bring people into this movement, to help people to show what the real potential is for what we can accomplish together. And then we collaborate. That's a little different than connecting. Connecting sometimes means we get two people in a room, we get the heck out of the way. Collaboration means we really sitting down and working on, okay, how do we solve these problems together? What is the real obstacle that's preventing growth? In Arizona, for example, we looked at just a lack of awareness. There's only one regenerative organic certified farm in the region. It's growing very rapidly, and 96% of the food they import. So having an organic market there is really challenging because of the lack of growers and the lack of infrastructure to really support it. So, but when we put all these things together, you know, some amazing things can happen. And that's one of the things I'm going to be encouraging, you know, everybody here on the call today is, what can you do on your farm, in your business, in your organization to really stimulate change and create an environment where change is more palatable, less scary, and, you know, dare I say, fun if we can do it right. And how do we look at the work to be done as a collaborative effort? We work with a guy named Tito Fuentes in Tucson. He runs a group called Flowers and Bullets, which is an inner city farm that serves their community. And one of the things he says is that we love is, if you want to do something fast, do it alone. But if you want to lift something heavy, do it with the community. And that's really what we see kind of is needed here when we're looking at changing the food supply and bringing organic farming into a more prominent position within agriculture, and not just organic farming, but the methods behind organic farming and just the idea of non-toxic food in our food supply. And how do we elevate that as an idea and create the more awareness and adoption of this? So I want to show you guys about a 3-minute video. Hopefully it goes with your lunch, if you're snacking on lunch or anything like that. It's it really just compiles the work we're doing in Arizona and shows the idea of communities working together. And then we'll come back and we'll walk through the 5 realities that that we're learning on the ground when we're working with groups like this. So I hope you enjoy it.
Sound of
So I appreciate you hanging in there with me for that. It's just wanted to show what, you know, one example of how we can illustrate what this is all about. When we talk about whether it's organic farming, sustainable farming, regenerative farming, whatever term we're using to describe this system that works with nature, right? It's about bringing people to the farm. It's about being on the land. It's about being, you know, as part of this ecosystem. And that's one of the things that we really wanted to show with that video, is that was a lot of people who were not farmers, but were food supply. Those were restaurant folks. Those were cooks. Those were advocates from the region. Those were high school principals. These were input companies that we brought, and they were sleeping on the farm and camping on the farm and being a part of this system. They saw the sheep get out in the middle of the night. They heard the sheepdogs barking all night, keeping them up. They got to see the sheep herders jump in the trucks and go get them back in the you know, pastures. They got to see 104 degree heat in the middle of the day and what that feels like working out there. And it was a little bit of suffering went a long way to show what the realities are of this farming. And when we talk about, you know, opening new markets or sales or, you know, we really talked about relationships within a community. And that's really what we're trying to build is in bring back together, I should say build, but repair. That's all often what we've lost when we've gone into the larger conventional markets for our food supply, is those local relationships. And those relationships we learned during the pandemic are really what build resilience, right, into these markets, is those relationships. Those are what stand. The truck routes break down, the flights break down, the shipping lanes break down, but those relationships stay strong, and we have them. We can create real solutions. So that's what brings me to the reality number one, which is community is essential. You know, it's just something that we can't underline enough. When we work with growers, how often they tell us this: I'm out here all alone. We hear that so much all over the country, that especially folks who are thinking differently or farming differently or not on the commodity market, they've lost some of those relationships, right? And it's actually one of the reasons that prevents people from changing is the idea that they will become isolated in their communities. We've seen rural communities be eroded in the last 60 years since cities have started to grow. And we see that infrastructure go. And there's a real fear of, you know, we call it, we have a term here, we call it the reality of the church pew. You know, is that if everybody in your church pew is going to change systems and go organic, you're probably going to too. But if everybody's not, and in your community, that's something that's not being considered, it's going to be really hard to break off and be different, because these are relationships between your salespeople, with your seed salespeople, right? Fertilizer salespeople, your neighbors, you know, that sometimes become challenged when you're just talking about changing your farm system. So that's where, you know, creating more of us out there and creating more organic farming systems that people can see and observe and understand. And like I said, be comfortable being on the farm is important, but we have to work together and we have to connect. That's why even though we're doing this virtually, why things like this are important, just to make sure that we all understand that there's so many of us out there working in this space and that can share these common challenges. I'm off by myself. I don't get to talk about my farming practices at the coffee shop because my neighbors don't want to understand them. That's why I come to these things. If you aren't making money, then let's share the problem. If you're willing to lose money and control the land, what are you saying about risk and partnerships, right? A lot of times when we're just getting started, it's so hard to become profitable. So again, when we talk about finding the community of growers to work with, finding the community of buyers that want to participate with the food we're producing, is one of the critical steps in building those relationships. This one's about a landlord. That can be a challenge when we talk about building communities. This comes from a grower up in Spokane. He said, never once had they asked me to invest in their soil. That's what they were paying property taxes on. So once it was spun that direction, I felt like they joined the bus and wanted to be part of the journey, right? And this idea was, you know, they literally had to, for this landlord, create a management plan for all the structures on the property, all the barns, all the facilities, all the fencing. They had to create a management structure for all the tools and equipment, like the tractors and the maintenance programs. And they had to submit that every year, but they never had to submit a maintenance and improvement program for the soil, right? And this is what they were actually being paid to manage and do. And that was a big leap for the landlord to understand, like, oh, this is what I'm actually hiring this farm manager to do, is build soil. I came out here with a heavy heart and loads of anxiety, but everyone's kindness and generosity was so comforting for my soul and truly grateful. don't ever underestimate it, just like knocking on somebody's door, seeing how they're doing. Like when we're talking about the farming, it's hard work what you guys are doing. I'm still lit up from attending, right? These things matter. You know, doing things in your community, you don't have to do, you know, large events, but just having a dinner party, you know, and having people over and talking about these things and seeing what's working. Like these things, I do realize they take effort and time and energy and money, but they really are worthwhile and impactful. And it really is what we need to see continued adoption of what we're talking about. So community, right? Community, community, community. I can't underline that enough. When we survey groups as a whole, just for the record, it hardly ever comes up. Things like labor, climate, weather, those are the biggest problems that come up. When we survey people one-on-one, biggest problem that comes up is a lack of community. So it really is like a challenging thing to bring up in a group. And it is something that people are sometimes are fearful to talk about, is needing that community as well. So, but it's a fact, it's there, and it's part of this of farming. We want it to be more of a part of farming, I should put it that way. Reality number two, biology is the bridge. That we talk about, how do we transition into new systems or away from conventional agriculture? We talk about a lot of times is taking care of the biology. For so long, chemistry drove our farming systems around the country and now around the world. And now we're really understanding that biology has the primary and central role. And that's maybe old science that we're rediscovering and really relearning and really understanding, is that the microbiology in the soil, the stronger and the more diverse our microbiology is in the soil, especially around the rhizospheres and our root structures, the stronger our crops are, the more resilient they are to weather, the more resilient they are to pests and disease, and the less they need fertilizers and inputs. And we're really understanding that there's a large, really strong connection between caring for the biology, which is generally what we disrupt when we use synthetic systems in our field. We're disrupting that biological system and we're creating suboptimal systems. So there's a researcher named Dr. James White. I don't know if anybody's heard of him. He works out of Rutgers University. He studies these systems approach. We're really fortunate to have his support. He looks at microbiology's relationship with rhizosphere, how it goes in and out of the plant, how it delivers nutrients into the root, and then how it can be expelled back into the soil to then go collect more nutrients, bring it back into the plant. And that is just a hyper-efficient process when it's working correctly. So I just got about a one-minute video where he explains why biology in these farming systems is so important and how we can explain that to others.
For your growers, the biological people who are interested in biological agriculture, biological farming and gardening, that's really how plants work. They work through biology. And if you just use chemistry, that's only part of the way that plants work. And I'm talking about all plants. There's no plant in nature that uses only chemistry. This is a fabrication of our human mind. We invented chemical agriculture, and it works, but it's not optimal for plants. Plants are weaker when you grow them using only chemistry, when you mess up the biology, when you don't encourage that biology, when you don't make it so plants can get access to the biology, they're much weaker. They're not hardy, they don't get the nutrients. You're basically guessing what the plant needs. I mean, we can make it very sophisticated and get analyses every few days to try to put stuff in, but then you have to try to guess. You're guessing what the plants need, and you basically have taken the agency away from the plant. And these plants have their own capabilities of attracting microbes that carry the nutrients that they need. So it's really better for the plant and for the environment with less contamination to support the plant directly and the plant biology, and to minimize the use of chemicals as much as possible. It may not always be 100, it's not 100% possible. Sometimes there's no alternatives, but we have to do the best we can in order to support the plant and the plant's use of biology and growth. And that'll get rid of a lot of the problems that we're having in agriculture and also in human health, you know, so it goes beyond just plant health.
He brought up a point there at the end that this is connected to human health. I asked him to, you know, explain what definitively we could talk about with soil health being connected to human health. And he said we could say that all indications are pointing to the more diverse, excuse me, more diversity of microbiome that we have in the soil will lead to a larger nutritional impact in the food that we're growing in that soil. And so that's really the research that organizations like Bio-Nutrient Food Association and others, Aaron Martin down in Oklahoma with Fresh RX, she's working on this, which is, you know, and there's 12 states now that have adopted food as medicine prescription programs where they're now using Medicare and Medicaid dollars to purchase organic food. And that's a huge new market that we can talk about continuing to try to open up for growers like yourself that we really believe is the future, where we see preventative medicine. And that's being pushed by the insurance companies. They've really seen that in the last 2 years of life, we spend about 50% of our health care costs are on the last 2 years of life. That's a burden on insurance companies. And they've seen that that's nutrition-based risk. And so they've looked and they've asked doctors and family practitioners to address that nutrition-based risk through, and that's where Medicare and Medicaid programs are starting to participate and do experimentations. Mostly it's with type 2 diabetics right now who can qualify for those programs, but they're seeing a decrease in A1C levels in Oklahoma. This year, they've started it, they're 7 months in, and they've seen a decrease between 1.1 and 2.2 points on A1C levels across the board for participants in their program. So it's really, 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 really strong indications that we're going to continue to see healthcare markets open up for organic growers, and maybe those can become some guaranteed buys in the long run through your local medical practitioners. So again, biology, it's connected to a lot of things. It's also one of the biggest challenges, right? We've sometimes taken one biology class in high school, and or if we're lucky, and that's about the only exposure we really have an understanding of biology, even though we're farmers and ranchers and we work with biology a lot. Sometimes we just need to remind ourselves and go back to the basics and explore what photosynthesis is and really understand how carbon cycles through the plant and these types of things that we can get familiar with. There's going to be a skills gap on that note, right? That as this comes from farmers in Oklahoma, actually, that we work with to talk about that as they recruit others to participate in this program and growing organically, that folks aren't always comfortable being bad at something, right? Which is generally on the learning curve, you know, that you gotta, when you step into something new, you're gonna struggle with it at first and then you're gonna get better at it over time. A lot of times that's hard, especially if you've been farming 20, 30 years, you know, and especially if you're talking about generational change when you're inheriting your family's farm, they've been farming a certain way for 30 or 40 years. They don't necessarily wanna see them reset their knowledge gap when somebody adopts the farm or says, I want to now farm organically. Well, that's given up a lot of institutional knowledge for better or worse. And so there's a skills gap that sometimes needs to be addressed. And that's where, you know, folks who, you know, if you're an advanced organic grower or you've really figured things out in your farm, again, inviting others in to learn from what you're doing can really help accelerate this type of work. It's about seeing and being a part of it as much as anything, right? On that note, this is a hands-on endeavor. You have to see it. You have to taste it, you can be inspired by it or overwhelmed by it, but it drives action, right? It's just idea of being on the farm, understanding what soil health is like, smelling it, right? Actually, I know some farmers who taste their soil because they want to get a certain flavor profile out of their, you know, these wine growers, right? They're a little, you know, strange sometimes, but they really do have a flavor profile, and but it's amazing to watch, and they know what they're talking about. So it's this thing, right? This is a Yachty down in Arizona, just digging a hole in the middle of his wheat field, showing, you know, a few folks what he's doing there. So it's just a little bit of inspiration, right? All it takes is a shovel and a pair of shoes, you know, and getting folks out there and showing what we're talking about. Right, this is the more complicated version of what we're talking about. I just wanted to show this. This is from Dr. White's research as well. We're really just talking about when we're farming with nature, we're talking about feeding that rhizophagy cycle, which is really just that relationship between endophytic bacteria, which is bacteria that works inside the plants, and the nutrients that are available in the soil. Generally, what it leads down is a slippery slope where you start seeing patterns all over the place. Once you start stepping in your fields, right, you start looking around, you start seeing, oh, there are, you know, it's not chaos, which is what we've been trying to control with our synthetic systems a lot. When I do all day leadership programs, we actually do about 45 minutes just on the chaos theory, where we talk about the math that is involved in chaotic systems. And chaos does not mean that it's unreasonable. It just means it doesn't look like there's a reason from our perspective. But when we boil down to it, there is. And that's why things like, you know, stems on leaves and look like river systems, which look like deltas, and, you know, fern leaves look like hurricanes, and these types of things. These are not accidents, right? And so when we start farming with nature, that's really what we're looking for. We're looking for these signals from nature that will help us understand what the plant needs, what the ecosystem needs, and what we need as humans living within that ecosystem. And so sometimes that's one of the biggest mindset shifts of farming this way that we've learned working with farmers, is it's really going away from absolute control, right? Where I'm going to continue to control and apply my direct controls on the ecosystem until I get exactly what I want, which is an expensive proposition in the long run, to I'm going to be a part of something bigger than myself and try to work within it to get what I want. And that's a big mindset change, and sometimes can be quite scary and quite difficult to explain. There's a guy named Jerry Brunetti. I don't know if anybody's heard of him. He was somebody explaining this in the 80s and 90s quite a bit. He was talking about, he was exploring with his research, you know, insects talking to plants and signaling them. When a boll weevil would land on a cotton plant, it would signal a wasp to come in and kill the boll weevil. And this was actually happening. And we were disrupting that with some of our synthetic systems that we were applying in there, and how there was long-term effects to that. He was exploring how he was one of the first to see how bugs were coming in and actually chewing up pesticides and spitting them out, right? That they were actually adapting and learning from the programs that we were putting on, and how the nature was going to continue to push back. So he had a term that he liked to call quantum coherence. And that was his goal for all farmers, is to farm within an ecosystem and to have an to be a signal catcher, to be walking the fields and understanding what the field's telling you, to be able to dig some soil and be able to hear what to sense what the soil needs, and to really use all five perceptions, senses when we're walking our fields and when we're farming. And that's, you know, smelling and sniffing and tasting and doing all of them. So I wanted to play a brief quick clip of him explaining quantum coherence. And there's a fish that he mentions, and I'll just reiterate it. He says California smelt, and it's really a small fish. They pool in the millions together, but they are a good example of how sometimes nature is really tuned in and what we can learn from it. So there's Jerry with his cats.
Here's an interesting way of looking at, you know, nature's knowing how to do things. The sun, California smelt, you know, it spawns at the highest tide on the third day after the full moon in May, and only then. It's carried to shore on the last highest wave, where it's going to lay its eggs, and then it's taken back out to sea. The adults are taken back out to sea on the next receding wave, and the eggs are safe now because all the other receding waves don't come in as far, right? It knows exactly when to drop those eggs. 14 days later, high moon shows up again. High tide appears, the eggs hatch minutes before that high wave hits the shore and being swept out to sea. So in other words, the quantum coherence of nature in this example shows you that there's only 1 minute of the year when the relative positions of the sun, moon, and earth are exact that phenomena occurs. 1 minute in the entire year that those spelt know when to drop their eggs and they know when to leave. That's it.
Anyway, I like that story. Can we 1 minute's a pretty tight window, but can we operate in that same way when we think about when we plant, when we harvest, if we do have to spray, if we do have to weed, can we do it in a way that we're cognizant and in a way that when nature invites us in overall? So biology, just to summarize, it's such a big key, is really understanding how biology works, and just the brilliance and wisdom that's a part of the biology may not be something we fully understand, but we are starting to understand more and more of it and how it can feed us. So reality number three, and I'll move quickly through this one, because the problem is the hard part, right? When we explain why are we organic farming, or why are we farming sustainably, or why are we focused on soil health, or why are we focused on these larger impacts beyond just yield, you know, within our systems, that can get really confusing to consumers. That can get, you know, what are we doing, right? Are we And how are we doing it? There's labels, there's certifications, there's, you know, so many things out there to help consumers, quote unquote, help consumers, that actually we've learned does quite the opposite, right? And it creates actually a lack of trust. In most surveys, the non-GMO is about the most trusted certification that we see out there, quite honestly, because there's not anything else like it, really. It's kind of stands alone, and it's very clear. It's non-GMO. Like, it's very clear what it is and what it stands for. Some of the other certifications are sometimes more challenging to explain the real value out there to the farmer or to the consumer, excuse me. So we'll go through quickly, kind of go through the problems that sometimes get brought up in organic farming, sustainable farming. Either way, no matter what we're talking about, we have to demonstrate success, right? This is a quote that, you know, coming from a doctor in Oklahoma working with us that said, hey, whatever you guys are doing, you have to be able to demonstrate success, right, in the end. So we can't pick a problem that we can't solve, in other words, right? So if we're picking problems that we struggle to solve, we're going to really struggle to get the support and the momentum we need. This is generally where people hear about regenerative agriculture. It's very similar for organic agriculture, so that's why I left this in here. Generally, it's online, right, and through the news. So it's usually a bad news event, right, or something like that, that they will get clued into, that will tune somebody into the needs or the ideas. That's both an opportunity and a challenge for us, right, as growers and trying to break into these new markets. We have lots of opportunities because of how disrupted the food supply is to talk about alternatives, but oftentimes getting folks to change in a moment of crisis is obviously sometimes the hardest time to do it. And so that's... And so certainly getting their attention for a long-term span around a crisis and is a hard thing to do in the news cycle. So, but generally, if you're looking at where do I market and where am I going to reach people around new markets, online is one, because that's where people are hearing about these types of things. But word of mouth, can't say enough about that. This is a program in Iowa for... mostly ethanol growers wanting to talk about carbon, right? This carbon was the problem that they brought up here, and they were able to get growers in the room to talk about farming slightly differently, using cover crops specifically, not necessarily organic, but starting to move that direction, right? There's a lot of skepticism in the room. Why would I ever want to not pollute when all my competitors are polluting? I mean, that was kind of the theme in the room. And I know this group probably has a lot of good answers for that, but they're, you know, it's about finding that problem that people can relate to and want to respond to as well. This is a small group talking about healthcare, nutrition, you know, more personal stories. Sarah Koh, she's a nutritionist. She's one of the things she measures for folks is their heart rhythm. So they're the space between their heartbeats, to really understand that when you're in a stress, that's in a stress state, that's an erratic. You don't get the same frequency. When you're in a calm state, you actually get a repeatable frequency. And, you know, there's some basic heart techniques that farmers are learning to, you know, take a deep breath before you go cuss out the tractor, bed for breaking down again, or these types of common stresses that happen over and over and over and over again. So how do we, you know, detox farm? But anyway, where I was going with this is really healthcare is also something that brings people in. This is a news cycle. This was in my home state of Illinois earlier this year, where we had a dust bowl incident, right? Where we had major winds come through right before planting, take a bunch of topsoil, blind people out in the middle of the interstate, and it actually there were six fatalities as part of this accident. It was terrible tragedy, and it was unfortunately how people get introduced to farming sometimes, is, you know, and it's some of the challenges we're trying to work on when we talk about why these systems are important. Is we, you know, this picture should explain why these different alternative farming systems are important, because we know what the alternatives can lead to. And the other way people learn about this, celebrities, they're talking about this more and more, right? I don't know if anybody's seen Nick Offerman's commercial out there that he's done. He was on Parks and Rec for many years, a comedian, but he's now out there doing soil health commercials and advocacy around cover cropping and these type of things. So it's kind of amazing. I'm not going to play the commercial. You can YouTube it, but I don't have the rights. So I can't afford the rights to Nick Offerman commercials, but he's out there and you can go look at him. And he's... and I think that's, you know, for better or worse, right? But there is more interest in this stuff. And so how do we make sure that the problems they're bringing up are ones that we can actually solve? That's a whole different challenge sometimes. In the end, right, integrity is important. no matter what problems we're solving, that we have to be able to generate good outcomes. And that's really what we're trying to talk about when we talk about what problems are we solving. So quick example, we talked about carbon. Carbon's a pretty common one that we hear all over the place. Carbon pollution, carbon sequestration. Why do we need more alternative farming systems? We're seeing the beef industry get beat up quite a bit, mostly unfairly, quite honestly, based on the research we've seen. And these are really confusing. They're selling carbon credits as kind of the new marketplace out there. We have not seen many farmers really benefit at all. I just caution everybody to be really careful about going into this without really understanding what you're selling at some point. This is another way to look at pollution. We talk about what problems are we solving. Energy is just a really complicated thing when we start pulling on threads of like, where does agriculture rank? Well, it's like, where does food rank in our ecosystems? Like, it's just connected to so many different things. The challenge of that is trying to determine what our impact can potentially be. The benefit is we know once we start making an impact, we will have one heck of an impact that will, you know, connect with energy, will connect with all sorts of different threads that we're a part of as an agriculture industry. So it's important, but again, we can get really lost in this conversation. It's another way that people find this: greenhouse gas emissions, right? Comes up quite a bit. Food waste, we hear that. Just showing some common, again, ways people are hearing about this movement and how we can relate our own farming activities to them. Carbon prices, I don't know about you, but I would struggle to sell anything with this big a range of pricing around the world. It goes from almost zero to $137 per unit, and that's volatile. And we know that when we really talk to the agronomists and they stand in the middle of the field, they talk about carbon cycling. It's not sequestration, right? It's never staying put. If we're actually rebuilding our systems, we're actually regenerating our systems, we're actually putting carbon to work, right? And it's actually moving through the atmosphere, moving through the soil, moving through our plants, moving through the animals grazing on our land, and continuously moving through that system. So it's less sequestration and more movement. We want to keep it moving through our systems in a positive way and not escaping. Human health, that's another one. We relate to organic farming, sustainable farming quite a bit. This was somebody in our, can't remember where it was, I think Kansas program that said this, that we laughed at this one, that it was, you know, there's so many pressures working against us, right? To try to introduce nutritious, you know, food and healthier food systems in there, including, you know, school districts can be one of the biggest challenges. You know, what we get served at school lunches, if you're a parent, you know, is a big challenge out there. We see this quite a bit too, that once health issues hit, they snowball, right? It's not just one thing that happens. It's something over and over and over and over and over again. So that's really what we're trying to prevent, is those really, really, really costly health cycles that that so many folks, especially in America, are going through. We spend 40% more per person than any other country. That's just a fact. And that's one of the inefficiencies we talk about that we can address with organic farming. Healthcare is not a new topic, just for the record, even though there's a lot of new research coming out. This guy is named Dr. William A. Albrecht. He published a research in 1943. He got all the dental records for all the World War II draftees. He was able to map out where they had cavities around the country. He had just finished a calcium phosphate soil testing for around the country and was able to map calcium phosphate levels. Well, that's what teeth are made out of, right? So he was able to show that where we had the heaviest, most industrialized soils, which were along the East Coast, we had the heaviest cavity concentration. And where we had the largest concentrations of calcium in the soil, which is like Western Kansas and these areas, had almost zero cavities. So he was pretty famous for, if you walked in his office and smiled, he'd be able to tell you what part of the country you're from based on your smile. But again, this is almost 80 years old research that he was able to connect soil health to human health almost 80 years ago in a peer-reviewed way. And again, that so this is not new, and this is not anything that we haven't known for quite some time. Infrastructure, that comes up a lot as well. What problem are we solving? Where with local foods, we've broken the local food infrastructure. We've seen our rural towns lose their high schools or lose their population bases overall. And that's unfortunately through some real intent that we have to focus on bringing infrastructure to help you guys open markets and drive sales. You know, that's why we'll end up talking about you know, we end up talking about trucks and refrigerators and freezers before long, because it's really what's the critical pieces that are out there. We can't replace the sugar, right? There's high competition out there in the food supply against healthy food as well. We've got sugar in almost every product out there, and that's just a massive flavor feedback loop that we're trying to replace. It just, you can't replace it with a tomato without, right? At first, it's a gradual process to get people weaned off of that type of food and into something healthier and more nutritious. We're not feeding the world, just the record. That's also why we need to talk about alternative food systems. If you live in Appalachia, go walk through Appalachia and tell them we're feeding the world and see what they tell you. They're feeding themselves, but the bigger food supply is not getting there. This is where I live in Illinois. Those are all food deserts. Like, this is the healthiest, it's like some of the healthiest soil in the world, right? And when we talk about infrastructure, there's just realities, right? I do this picture. To the left, that's a model upscale grocery store that's going to open in Chicago next year. They want to just work with family farmers and local food farmers and organic farmers in Illinois. So we've been trying to help them identify them. Here's what we're finding. On the bottom right, that's the distribution. That's the biggest distribution center we can find that will serve family farmers in Chicago. They represent about 80, 90 farmers. That's the farmer's son and a high school girl. That's their total employee base that works at this distribution center. How much can they scale up to serve a Chicago market right now without getting some capital, some risk-free capital and folks coming in? Above is one of the farmers that they're serving. That's a handwritten invoice, right? And so we're talking about, you know, massive infrastructure needs to just start to get back to open these supplies up. And it's going to take, you know, philanthropy in a lot of areas to get these things happening, because just the cash flow is not there on the grower side to match the capital there on the market side. So I'll fast forward through that. Anyway, that was just a video that showed all the family farmers in his county. There's about 12 of them standing in the field. So, you know, we just need more growers out there as well. This is an interesting slide. This is from Tito in Tucson. You know, when we talk about problems, the problems we're solving, we also have to be careful. A lot of areas are scared when a new grocery store comes in, because it means gentrification comes in right behind it. And we've seen that in a lot of areas around the country. In fact, so Tito's runs a 10-acre farm in Tucson. It's right downtown. He actually took over a school that burned down in their campus and turned it into an organic farm. He's fighting every challenge you can imagine. Stuff gets stolen all the time. He's had goats get stolen. He's had equipment get stolen. But he knows he's there to serve his community. So it's and he's got to keep his community together. And so that's his quote. And it's challenging for a lot of people when they see that quote. And lastly, farmer share, so important, right? That we get you guys, the producers, what they deserve. That might resonate, you know, that we got to get you guys a bigger share of the food supply for us to really think that more people are going to enter this market and more people are going to do what you guys are willing to do on a daily basis. This might resonate, right? As we talk about opening markets, that, you know, if you're selling into a farmer's market or something like that, you know that they can still go through the drive-through lane on the way home from the farmer's market, right? But they can't always find you. And that's just a big challenge. Farmer share, the red line is farmer share, the gray line is productivity, right? Can we get those starting to match? That as productivity goes up, the work you guys are doing on the farm is extraordinary. The compensation for it is not. It's just another graphic, the way to look at it. The second line is farm production. It's getting your line, you've seen it's really been struggling since the pandemic. How do we get that line above? That there's been a lot of other costs come into the supply chains since then, and you guys are getting, you know, push down even as prices are going up, but you know, transportation prices have gone up, legal and accounting, advertising prices, just about everything across the board has gone up and taken that market share and kept, you know, farmers and growers below the historic norms. Generally, we talk about positioning. We want to get you guys out of the tail end of the food supply chain in people's minds if we can with our marketing. And we talk about opening markets. We like this image instead, where you guys are in the middle, we're farmer, because you guys are dependent and reactive on so many market forces and so many economic and cultural forces for what you're planting, why you're planting it, who you're planting it for. All, you know, it could be landlords, it could be markets. There's all sorts of signals that determine that. So we really want to get this in folks' head that farmers are not starting the supply chain by any means. You guys are reacting just like everybody else, and then folks are reacting based on what you're growing. But it really isn't a, you have every right to get the majority of the product if, you know, the product price based on where we position this is that you're absolutely essential and that everybody should be reacting based on what farmers are doing, not expecting farmers to take whatever scraps are left at the end of the day. Other problems that we talk about, it gets really complicated, right? So we just want to make sure that we're whatever problems we're talking about solving with our farming or our new farming systems or farming differently, that we're just clear and we're consistent with them. So I by no means am I saying that we have to cover all of these and solve all these problems with our farming, but they do come up quite a bit. And I'm going to move pretty quickly through that. We got about 5 to 10 minutes left, but I'll try to move pretty quickly. Policy is the other thing that's coming up. It is a farm bill year, even though it got moved back a year. We have a year to hopefully get a few things into the farm bill. This is Jimmy Emmons. His quote, the farm bill's hung up right now. There's some space to inject some things, right? He works in this space and is really trying to bring, you know, he's got to use climate smart with his term. He doesn't get to use organic, but it's just another kind of term to describe what we're talking about. Historically, we've been fighting policy for 80, 90 years, you know, trying to get space for an alternative. This is just an old political cartoon from 1929. At the time, there was a group that said, hey, we want to monopolize energy. We just want to create one energy company, and that will make it more efficient and equitable for all. You can imagine the U.S. And most Americans did not like that idea. They pushed back. But that was kind of the start of this idea of a few folks really looking at all of our major industries and trying to create strategies that basically lead to leverage for global economics and global trade. 1931, this might be hard to read on the bottom, the quote is no thanks, reinforced concrete for mine. The biggest challenge in the 30s was, again, industrialization was just ramping up. 1931, we built the Hoover Dam. That's the reinforced concrete joke in there, that had more reinforced concrete than any other project at the time in the world. And that's where the resources were going at a time when agriculture was really hurting, right? Dust Bowl and other time. So we're starting to see industry really isolate agriculture. That's today. I'm not trying to get political, but it's still accurate that we've just seen big ag get a lot of resources, and there's nothing untrue about this. It might be painful to look at, but you know, how do we get more resources and more materials that will support growers who are family farmers on the ground, not part of that top 5%? There's a roots in all this. I encourage everybody to look up the Adaptive Program for Agriculture. It was written in 1962. It really set the standard and the stage for why we have such an industrialized ag supply today and why it's that get bigger, get out. Friction is really pushing back and really a big hurdle for us to overcome for family farmers. It was a group of folks like J.C. Penney, Sears Roebuck, Ford Motor Company, Aluminum Company, all sorts of different large industries who got together, no farmers, just for the record, who got together and decided that the best case for farming would be to industrialize it like they have automotive companies. And that idea would be that we would be able to get back to world market share. We had lost Europe because we had been feeding them since World War II. We lost that share. They blamed family farmers. They brought in this panel and said, hey, we have to create a industrialized ag supply, because if we just had a few farmers farming everything around the country, everybody would be rich. And we'd have more food than we knew what to do with. And we could use that food to create leverage for world trade deals. We are recommending many governmental activities here that we'd usually regard as inappropriate. I just want to highlight that one. That's kind of the challenges that we can get done undone with the policies, is we have to create a level playing ground for you guys. Because right now, it's just not a level playing ground as far as where the resources and where the securities and the benefits are going to in agriculture. This was the study when it came out. They actually said we need to get rid of 2 million family farmers. That was the projection that they said that would help all of us. It was kind of all the quiet parts out loud. I'm not trying to roil you guys up. I just want to give you guys just a real quick picture of why it's so hard to do this stuff and what we're really working against. Is there's some real policy and real mindsets that we have to work change in this quote the Angus Farmers story. They talked about 50 family farmers going into a Sears Roebuck, having coffee with the manager and dropping off their Sears Roebuck catalogs and protest and creating a pile of them. So anyway, there's a long history again of trying to push back against this mindset and trying to create alternatives and just awareness that there has to be space for more than just large-scale farms. So the picture of who's on the committee, just to give you an idea. Running out of time, sorry. Although the exodus from agriculture in the past decade has been large by almost any standards, not been large enough. You get the idea. We need people out of agriculture, right? At the time, 44% of the farm population was below the age of 20. So they actually went in and created VOTEC programs and scholarships, right, to move kids out of the farm and kind of told them, hey, there's better jobs in the city, right? That might resonate for a lot of folks who probably got that lecture and probably got that conversation at one time in their life. I did, you know, when I was growing up, that I was second generation off the farm. My dad was the first. And if I had decided to go back to the farm, I'd been reversing progress, right, in our family history, right? That was kind of the idea, is we'd finally gotten off the farm. And that's one of the trends we're trying to relate. It's a wonderful job profession. And it needs to be. And it's an essential one that we need in our universe. Still happens to this day. So lastly, real quick, just trust gaps. I'm going to go through these really quick because I know we all have lives. But we talked a little bit about, you know, just building trust back. There's people who don't trust organics. There's folks in organics that don't trust conservation. There's all these buzzwords and buzz terms. And just we just have to be really cautious about you know, the terms we're using when we describe our organic farms and how we're describing the impact of those. And then we're bringing others. This quote, I just wanted to highlight. If you're working with folks who are new to this idea or nervous about it, I've done this to you today. I've thrown so much at you guys today over this hour of, we've talked about fractal math. We've talked about history. We've talked about policy. That's probably not the best way to explain it, your organic farming, because I threw a lot at you. But how do we create a focused message around what your farms are doing, what the message is, and what the real value proposition is in the end for organic farming? So in the end, your leadership's needed. We have to be personal with the folks that we're working with. You know, we can't be afraid to tell people about what we're doing, right? Explain the real impact that we're having. You guys, we need your leadership out there. We really appreciate what you guys are doing. You know, the way we're doing it here is we're connecting, continuing, we're creating something and we're collaborating. Can you guys think about ways to do that on your farm or in your operations or in your communities to help, you know, grow this idea of organic farming and sustainable farming and soil health? So, with about 1 minute to go, I thought I'd, get to the end of my slide. So thank you guys all for the time and the, participation today. So I'm available for any questions if anybody has any. And sorry, I had to hurry there at the end quite a bit. No? Well, feel free to reach out to me if you have any questions. I appreciate your guys' time today. We really are interested in hearing your guys' stories of organic farming and kind of what, you know, and the path you guys are on. It's been a pleasure just getting to talk to all you guys, you know, around the country that are doing this, because it's not easy, but at the same time, it's really, really, really essential. It's like our future depends on this work that you guys are doing. So thank you.
Before we wrap up, Felicity, would you give a quick preview of the next 3 sessions of this series?
Yeah. Thank you, Ryan. That was a great way to kick off our organic webinar series. You covered, like you said, a really broad range of things. So I appreciate that. And it was a great first session. We are going to be meeting here next week at the same time. And we will be talking a little bit about the organic certification process and the steps involved in that. The following week, we will be joined by a farmer panel of North Dakota farmers who will be talking about what they've faced, why they've decided to farm organically, and you would have the chance to ask them questions as well. And then the final week, we are going to be talking about just some of the different resources that are available as you are pursuing organic certification if that's something you decide to do. So just what resources are out there for you. So that's kind of a preview of the next few weeks moving forward. Thank you all for being here. And again, Ryan, thank you so much. That was a great presentation. I really appreciate it. All right.
Thank you guys.
Bye.